Namaste, good morning. I am Ambuja Salgaonkar from University of Mumbai. Me and my colleagues are here to share our experiences of imparting education to distance students and regular students, as well as specially gifted or challenged students. Mumbai University, as my colleague yesterday has mentioned, is a big complex system, one of the very, very early universities in India. We have 7 lakh students who are taking education in regular mode, and we have 1 lakh students, they are taking education in distance mode. Amongst the distance mode education, we have more than every year we get hundreds of students who are visually impaired and physically disabled and all. So that made us to think of how can we facilitate those people or differently challenged people, and can there be any system? This presentation has 3 types of things, I can say. One is about our experience of imparting education to the students. So we have developed some applications which we would like to incorporate as a part of Moodle. So plugins we are looking for. And towards the end, we will have some things which would help us for the taking the research ahead. So here, it's a story. Yeah, let me start with one of the success stories. Yesterday, many a times it is heard that regular face-to-face, what we call it, face-to-face university students or college students and teachers, they generally are not very enthusiastic in implementing Moodle kind of things, because they say that is something for the large scale. And when we meet every day, why should we go? And even if somebody enthusiastically set up some such venture, then updates are very rarely seen, and most of the times that has only vanity value, where my department has set up a Moodle server. So it is not continued. My colleagues only were telling yesterday ki, from Alkesh Dinesh Modi and all, ki, yeah, enthusiasm is less and we need to incorporate many features and all. How to do that is what the question is. Now, let me start with a story which is a true success story. My colleague Ani is there here. She wanted to, her responsibility was to handle 300 students, 2 midterm exams, assignment submissions, and a quiz per semester. So we all know, many of us yesterday shared this kind of experiences, ki this is very much burdened and where all the time is to go for the Moodle kind of activities. But here, once this was entrusted to her, she got Moodle as a solution. So she went on her own and set up her own Moodle server on her web page, where the college did not support initially. And then she could show that, yes, it works. For her, the challenge was, one more challenge was there. Yeah, teaching, administration, and research, those are trivial things for a college teacher and university teacher. But her college location is such that it is very tempting. It's at the seashore. So always finding out the students from the seashore and getting them into the class and then asking them to be in the examination, that was a task. And therefore, this lady decided, okay, let them enjoy the seashore, not a problem. Just what they have to respond to me from the seashore. And that worked very nicely. Now, yeah, it's a really true story, which I was also very much inspired by her gesture. Now, she has put up this thing, link is open for 15 days, which day you want to sit wherever, that's your choice. And then after that, the link will be closed, and then of course, then she can start her assessment, and then she does everything on Moodle assessment. As and when the assessment is carried out, immediately students are receiving the responses, ki what they have submitted, and then how they have made progress. So students are happy to listen to those things, ki, yeah, and they also can interact with amongst themselves, sitting in the seashore and then talking to the teachers. So this was a very interesting scenario, which I can say, and enjoy the learning and all that happened over there. Next was when she was successful in doing that, then the college management was interested in knowing what is happening. Every time she is on time and then students are enjoying and doing. It was a task for BCom and BS students, teaching them computer science. And still they enjoyed it. So then college people, when they know, okay, she has done something interesting, so how can we take it ahead? Then there were some people approached, that's under philanthropy, rural areas, teachers and students, how can we equip them? This lady went and set up a Moodle workshop, which also worked online, everywhere from the rural of Goa. She is from Goa. They attached, they connected to her server, and she had trained some of them, and sessions as per their requirement, their convenience, they are trained. And now, okay, one more step they want to go ahead, okay, how can we use these things for our people? So maybe there are a couple of hundred students in a school, and if you want to allow them or engage them, it's not a matter that how big setup you have. Given a very small setup also, you can encourage the students. That is what the story tells you. Most of us know the hole in the wall project that caught attention of a world in education. So a very small type of computer was put up, and many people were attracted towards these kids especially. And that was a kind of interactive and collaborative learning that they encouraged. Sugato Mitra's project. Now this happened the same, on the same line I can take this. She suggested ki don't go for 100 machines lab or something like that, which calls for money, which calls for administration and everything, which you probably may not afford. Now have a small lab where 10-15 machines are kept, and it will be open for a couple of hours after your office hours are open, office hours are done. Now the students will come over there, chit chat, interact, they can go for ground, play on the ground, whatever they want. And some of them will turn to this lab also, there they do something, and again this will continue. So the today's group may not be coming tomorrow, and therefore 15 machines are enough to take care of 200 students in that school. But that is how the freedom and volunteer learning was encouraged. Now the teachers, whoever were available from college and universities, they also can spare, means they being as a part of our Moodle venture. Now the mentoring is done online. It's not possible for me, even if I'm very enthusiastic to help my students and kids around, to allocate the time like every day I will be available on so and so day. But if it is available, if there is a calendar, I can say, okay, Mark, I'm available today. So either of us will be available and kids are taken care. So that's how it helped, and definitely that is one of the very success stories. Another success story I want to take ahead was about how to collect the feedback. Yesterday, my colleague, I do really appreciate her gesture of allowing us to participate in that feedback. How to keep the students engaged? Now, here it is, story of my colleague. She is Manisha. She always was thinking ki, collecting feedback from the students itself is a task, because we have to create questions on of different variety. So now creating a question calls for a different type of skills. So how to train teacher to teacher on that skill was a question. So her solution was not that. She said, okay, let us allow teachers, students, whoever wants to collaborate on that, creating a question, let us put a question bank. And then question bank, of course, when we create a question bank as a central effort, then it has to have a structured and sensible questions. Whereas my students and many of us also are not very good at creating a very good quality, clear questions, less vague questions, and given the type of the question based upon the given type, creating the question. So her solution was, we can have something like, let them create a raw question, and the raw question, she has created a program which modifies that question and get it to the well-formed question. So she calls it from ill-formed question to well-formed question. Now those well-formed questions become a part of our question repository. From there, another problem is solved when I was dealing with distance education of 1 lakh students, because of our engagement of the student and learning enhancement efforts, we had an idea ki every day let us put one question to the students. Let them answer or not, some of them will answer and others will at least come to know ki some such things are happening. Many a times in distance mode, it is a requirement that we should keep our students awakened. Chatbot was a wonderful thing, but then chatbot works, helps you when you go there and ask question. My requirement is that ki we have to go and check whether the students are awake, and if not, then we have to keep them sending alerts stating that be awake, here is something for you. So sending one question a day was an interesting idea. But my teachers had the same thing, ki every day sending a question may not be possible. Now this repository is readily available, so quickly they can pick up the randomly, the script takes up, a small script is there that picks up the question and sends it across. Now, how we created that? The question was how to create a large number of questions. There one of our experiences is that we were working with the spoken tutorial. And once the spoken tutorial, of course, that's also self-learning environment. After completing the spoken tutorial, a student is supposed to take a test and understand where which level the student is, a learner is. Now, for that, we had to, initially, we were enthusiastic in creating manual questions manually. Later on, when the number grew, like 1,000 students were trained, it was difficult for us. Then what we tried was always keeping a student's interest engaged is more happening more when we ask students to create questions than to ask we ask them to answer the questions. If we ask them to answer the questions, then most probably they pick up the answer from somewhere and post it, and there are chances they will copy. Instead, what I ask them is, now you have taken the tutorial, you pose a question so that I will learn the type of questions you are posing. I will know okay, how much you are through with. So that experiment, through that experiment, we created around 500 questions in 1 week, and the question bank was refined that time manually. But now I am sure we can go ahead with Manisha's EQQE, automatic question quality enhancer module.
Yeah, thank you. This is what an automatic quality question quality enhancer module. What we are expecting over here that instead of generating the questions, which is a job of the tutor, so we want to assist the tutor. Either the tutor can generate the questions, or supposed if we are providing a tool that what a machine can generate the question for us, that what a study material is being provided, the LSM, and based on that what a question can be generated. But of course we know that what artificial intelligence is playing a role over here. So we have to think that whether generated questions are of the good quality or not. So the observation is that some of the questions are accepted by the human annotators, but the few of the questions we have observed that they are within infirmities, like a grammatical is ungrammatical questions, or maybe the vague questions like that. So our module is that taking those questions generated by the machine or a human, it will find it out that based on the surface feature that those questions are ill-formed or well-formed. If the questions means based on those features, first of all, the score is being generated. So score decides that whether the question is to be acceptable or it would be rejected. So we have defined over here a threshold value that is above 3.5. We can say the questions need some sort of a modification, and below that what the questions mostly what we can say that what they should be rejected. So a score module will check the questions score based on that a rejection strategy, a modification strategy, or some sort of a sentence simplification strategy would be defined. So questions which are not being further enhanced, we observe that those questions are not being enhanced due to the complex structure of a sentence. So this is what a functioning of our small script. This is what one of the examples that I want to share with you. We are providing a simple sentence to the system. We call it as a best sentence. That Tirak obtained his Bachelor of Arts, a statement is to be. Now what machine is doing? Machine is automatically generating a questions based on this base sentence. Now a question generated, okay, we have to rate, means whether we should accept such questions or not. Now what happened over here, underlined phrase of arts is a partial phrase considered by a system to frame a question. And of course, a human evaluator has rejected this question, saying that what? A question is not correct because of what? Some of the part of an answer phrase is present in the questions. So what our suggestion is to be, so our EQQE model suggests that a complete answer phrase is this, that is Bachelor of Arts, and based on that, again, you reformulate the questions and give a correct question to the system. Similarly, another example, what we can say, this is very simple, a fact-based question is being generated. When two noun phrases comes with numeral adjectives, that time a system failed to extract those numeral adjectives. So one numeral adjective is extracted, but another numeral adjective associated with that noun phrase is not being removed by the system. So such kind of an errors are being marked and those are being removed. So these are what the benefits we can find. Of course, as we discussed in the morning, that we are not replacing the humans, or we can say the tutors, but we are assisting the tutors. So this saves the time. As questions are ready, so we can have to monitor that which are the good quality questions, which are triggering cognitive questions, and different kind of questions, like a fact-based as well as what general based questions can be formulated. And more engagement is being possible through this module. Thank you.
So with this, the question, the task was the student can just select the text and then questions are generated and then those are modified. Then we continued with the competitive spirit. Yesterday, one of the things was discussed ki, this is that how it is helping, and in our environment, that kind of culture is not there. Students are coming only for the examination purpose. I disagree with this solution, this opinion, because out of our experience, what we observed was, if there is a competitive environment, the spirit is already up. I can quote a number of examples where the previously students were not very enthusiastic, but because we kept on posting what is happening in the community, they were picking up, yes, I want to go ahead of somebody. And therefore, the healthy competition was observed. And automatically, as a side effect, we had so many things like content and all. Content and question banks were generated. So it is like results highlighted and posted on group, and get more pupils with added enthusiasm was our experience. Now, assessment of descriptive type responses. MOOC encourages peer evaluation. That was a very much thing ki when, well, my colleagues were scared of, ki 1 lakh students, you are asking us to send, keep online and internal evaluation tests and all. How are we going to face it? And I said, leave it to me as a CS person. Don't do it at yours. Pretty simple thing what we planned was, whenever we employ this thing for a small scale or large scale, when it is a Moodle, that doesn't make any difference to the machine. So for 300 students, if I can work with, for 30,000 students, doesn't make any difference as long as my machine, my server is supporting and we have good infrastructure. Now, MCQ type questions, automatically the logs and all were posted. We followed the same practice which was proposed in MOOC. Some of the times, a bunch of questions randomly, a teacher, human teacher, or the this one, teacher assistant, would evaluate and send the responses, share their opinions. So that keeps the community awakened, stating that yes, they are evaluating. Not that always 30,000 students' questions were evaluated by human. Then using the blog, using the log, at which time who posted the questions, we got to know ki who are sincere and all. For our opinions, whoever were responding, they were obviously very more sincere than the others. And therefore, almost our job of creating the records for internal, as a part of internal evaluation, was taken care. All that excitement was happening around, and one day I came across a student who came and told me, yes, I'm a part of this excitement, but can we reduce our my dependency? The person was visually challenged, and then we started evaluating what is available in the Moodle. So the things what we got were there, like screen reader, text-to-speech converters, simple interface, direct-to-links, and everything. Those are available. But then the things like shortcut keys, voice authentication, and word prediction plugins, which would be telling what is happening on the board, that was not there. Seriously, 5% of the VC, visually challenged people, keep mathematics at their SSC level because they don't find readers for them. Therefore, we went in that direction. Then one of my colleagues, Prashant, he worked on this problem and came up with an idea. We first studied what is the problem, why the normal screen readers are not the solutions for a mathematics text reader. To us, a mathematics text reader is something which has non-linearity involved into that. Just let me change the sequence bit. Mathematics X reader, see, there can be an example, okay, like X raised to 2 is something written over there. A linear reader cannot read that kind of stuff. So, Prashant has come up with a solution where we developed a syntax for linear reading of a non-linear text and then converted into it. So, this could be another plugin for a Moodle. Over to Prashant.
Good morning, all. Our basic aim was convert a non-linear mathematical structure into linear mathematical structure. And for that, we have developed the MathX, that is a mathematical text reader. This is a schematic block diagram of mathematical text reader, and we have the three blocks in it. The first block is a MathX input block. The second one is a MathX parser. And the third one is a MathX linear form generator. In the first part, we are supposed to take one image as an input. It will check whether it is a multi-line or not. If it is a multi-line, it will crop the lines. If it is a not multi-line, it will pass to the next block, that is a mathematical parser, where we are supposed to check the compound entities. Now here, take an example of the summation prod. We have taken them as a compound entity because these entities have been embedded with the lower limit and upper limit. Means, for example, if we have the summation, the lower limit is written at the downwards and the upper limit is written at the upwards. And we are supposed to scan all these characters. So we are just separating those characters, and later on we are passing to our OCR, where we are getting the proper text conversion of these entities. Later on, what we are doing, we are passing it to the MathX linear form generator, because suppose there is a one equation like the summation n running from 0 to infinity n. Here n is a changing variable, 0 is a lower limit, and the infinity is the upper limit. Now, while reading this, I will read it out, the summation n running from 0 to infinity, okay? But I want to know when to start, when to stop. So therefore, instead of calling summation, I'm calling it as a start summation and running from 0 to infinity end summation. So it is refining the scope of the summation. Later on, I'm passing all these to the Android TTS, which we have developed, and we are getting the proper voice output. I'm displaying some result over here. The first one is the simplest equation, that is a is equal to pi r square. Here, r pi r square, we can call, we can calculate the square of pi r also. Because whenever we are making a statement, A is equal to pi r square. We are making a statement for the VC. A is equal to pi r square. He may get impression that we have to calculate the square of pi r. But instead of, we are supposed to calculate the square of only r. So what we are going to do, we are trying to insert the parenthesis around the 2 and r. So the OCR expression will be A2 dash pi r raised to 2. So it will be called out as a start expression capital A equal to pi small r raised to start bracket 2 end bracket end expression. The second expression is the square root of a square plus b square. Here again, VC can get impression that the square root is only limited with the a square. Because whenever I'm passing this to the any text-to-speech converter, it will called out as a square root of a square plus b square. So there may be an impression like that the square root is only limited to the a square. So what we are trying to do, we are trying to put a bracket between the a square plus b square, and later on we are going to calculate the square root of that particular equation. So the verbalization will be the start expression square root of start bracket small a raised to start bracket 2 end bracket plus small b raised to start bracket 2 end bracket and the end expression. Later on, the third expression is about the compound entities, that is the summation and the prod. We are getting the output as a 5 sum A 2 dash 0 opening bracket A 5 product B 2 dash 1 opening bracket B, then the closing bracket, then there is a colon indicating that there is an end of the scope of the start summation, and it will be voiced out as a start expression start summation small a running from 0 to 5 start bracket small a start prod small b running from 1 to 5 start bracket, small b end bracket, end prod, end summation, and end expression. Thank you.
See, as we are looking forward to the next our research. See, as we are aware about, there are different OS LMS are available in the market, right? But Moodle has different features and unique features which are very much user-friendly to visual challenge learners as well as those who are proper visionary persons. So we have suggested we have given some suggestions for the Moodle that there should be a different plugin should be available as a which will be a very much customized and unique features for which will be a very user friendly to visual challenge learner, and also the compliance checkers should be available, screen and cursor magnifiers which we can increase the text, and we can screen magnification should be there, transcriptions, captions, affirmations before sending any assignments, then notices while leaving the pages, and the most common, that is the WhatsApp, the connectivity should be there, and simplicity like the course networking, also audio visual editing should be there, and all these features with along with the different training is also should be given to the administrators, because there are many features are available, many versions are coming in the market. So maybe about the MOOCs, we can give the proper training to these administrators in various institutions, and the our research will be focused more and more, and we can go for the Moodle in the better way.
So the idea here was we wanted to compare what are the other probabilities. As a part of my distance learning administrators, we offer the people many options, which of them they would like to take it. It is compulsory for a teacher to go for some such a system, but not need not be necessarily everybody will follow Moodle. So they came up with different, they came with diverse options. And in my experience, whenever the students were small in number, like say 200, 300, then the teachers did not prefer to go for Moodle because of the hazards involved in the setting up of that. And they settled on the course networking, the CN. So it is again curiosity of mine, can we not simplify our life with Moodle? Since I know as a CS person, ki Moodle offers you many things. The CN may not have those many features. There are Visa IQ and all also. But then customizing to the small scale is also one more thing which would be a requirement. Now, since yesterday, though we all are working in CS and working on the Moodle developments and all since many years, we also did not know many things whatever are happening in the world of Moodlers. So therefore, my idea was, why not to come up with a MOOC kind course, a course in a MOOC environment that will tell us about the Moodle happenings and who should use Moodle in which way. So the another thing was, Moodle can be used for the researchers, by the researchers. See, there are certain things where you cannot go for the people and ask them to help. They won't, generally. And therefore, research in many areas is lacking. See, for example, to my experts of visual challenging learners, to facilitate them, language was one of the barriers. But availing the Indian language translations itself is a task. So how do we go for that? Just 1 minute. Then the thing is, in that, she came up with a Konkani language translator. The linguistic resources are not available. So how to generate linguistic resources by providing the crowdsourcing? So this is Annie, to whom whose story I shared with you in the beginning.
Yeah, good morning, everyone. I come from a land where football is our passion and tourism is our business. But a little bit of education happens over there. And this is just a bit of research work in Konkani as a language, because this language has no script of its own. So I was thinking when I came for this Moodle workshop that if I can find some resources of plugging in such kind of things, which can incorporate and help people to work with. And I've just developed two of things. One is a UTF to WX converter, and one is a POS tagger. So this type of things we are looking at, because the resources in a language like Konkani is very low. It's very low, and people who know it are, even in parts of Kenya, you find people who are working with Konkani. So we just want to get something so Moodle can be a platform for such plugins. Thank you.
So the last part was how to administer the students' Moodle site for distance education. Here is Indrani, who worked there as an administrator with us, and a case study of IDOL she will present.
Okay, now I wanted to highlight the points that distance learners face. Like we are talking generally, I teach in a college where it's a blended learning, not a distance learning, but distance learners have different kinds of issues. I'm just discussing the challenges of the distance learners. First is we don't know the students personally. They are in the distance, so we need to know their background. So for that, user profile is system defined. So we need to use this custom user profile to add their profiles, so that everybody know, the teachers during orientation, they can know about the backgrounds. Then we have the study materials, problem of study material dispatch, where the study materials need to be collected from the contact centers, and courier to the remote areas is a problem. So we can use them for, the Moodle is very much, we can use it for uploading the course materials where they can use it. Then we can create blogs for the topics. We have a problem with the study materials management also. Like, we need to know that which teachers are submitting the study materials on time. We need to monitor them. So that facility I have not actually seen. Here we have the announcements forum where we can send notifications, as well as this calendar block is there with reminders where we can add the events and set the reminders. But this reminder plugin is general, like it is not specific to particular courses. So that is one problem which we face. So task cannot be allotted to teachers. It can be allotted, but reminders setting is a problem. Next is learner orientation. Because they are distance learners, they come only for the examination. So we need to orient them. So for that, the quiz and all the activities we are using here, we have this quizzes, we have assignments, interactive drag and drop questions, all these which we are using. Okay, there is a process of like summative grading also, but we can improve this. Like for we should have the possibility of assigning marks for particular questions. Here we can do annotations and we can apply the grades. So students can, like, you if they give a paper that can be uploaded. And we can grade it for assessment. That privilege is there, but nowadays, like in Mumbai University online assessment, we for particular question we have the privilege to add marks. That I didn't see. Okay, next is okay. So we students as co-creators. So we can actually, if you take the video of the students, like let them create their own videos, they will be very much engaged in the lecture. So we have in my college, we have used a bridge course. We have done a bridge course for digital electronics, in which we have taken the students' videos and uploaded them, and we have actually embedded them in Moodle. Next is for projects for computer science, especially we have project documents and we have the deadlines. Like they have to upload the documents proposal, then they have to upload the diagram. So we need deadlines for that. So we can create folders and they can upload the documents and we can see the logs. Next problem is diverse enrollment profile. That is, we need adaptive learning. For that we can use groups. For computer science, another problem we have is the practicals. Practicals we cannot conduct online, but we have online compilers. Like we should be able to integrate online compilers with Moodle, but that can be done only here with third party. We can use a trinket where we can create the code, and you can see we can change the students can change the code and they can get the output. They can see the teacher's questions. Next is for visually challenged ones, we are using this accessibility plugin in which there is an AT bar, and we have text to speech, we have dictionary, we have word prediction tools, all these are there.
Everyone's talking anyway, so come on. I think we need to finish.
Yes,
very much
definitely.
Sorry.
Okay, so we have this text to speech options in which you can highlight the text and the teacher students can read. There is a reader. Then there's a line spacer, there is an intelligent typing facility available. For learning disability, dyslexia students, we have this special fonts for dyslexia, in which they have that, they think the font moves, so here also the font moves. If you see it online, it moves.
I might interrupt. I think if anyone wants to see these things, that maybe we could talk at lunch. You could present at lunch.
Sure. This is done.
Other people, it might be nice. I would love to give you an hour, but we have other people and we've got to run out of time.
This is the last slide.
Yeah, okay.
Thanks for a patience listening.
5 seconds.
There were a lot of enthusiasm. There was a lot of enthusiasm and so many things we tried. In fact, the communication was something. I am supposed to take 30 minutes, so we arranged so many things. Maybe because of the more overwhelming response, there was a time cut down. But it's okay. I thank you very much for giving us this opportunity and look forward to continue with this.
Thank you very much. I feel bad.